So, here's a weird question. How full should you fill a gas tank for maximum fuel efficiency? How much go-go juice makes a Vroombox zoom furthest with the fewest dino carcasses? Also, like, why the hell do we, and by we I mean North Americans, call it gas when it isn't even remotely a gas? To everyone else, I'm sorry, petrol's a much better word. I mean, who wouldn't rather stuff a bunch of seabirds in a tank? Anyways, this seems like an either pointless or simple question, and you're probably sitting there wondering why the hell this even matters. How much of a difference can it really make? And, well, it probably doesn't even make a difference at all. But maybe, just maybe, you're curious enough to find out. So, in order to answer this utterly life-changing question, we need to have a basic understanding of fuel efficiency. In short, the number of kilometers you can drive on a liter, miles you can drive on an ounce, or chiles you can drive on a Lake Ontario are all dependent on two main factors: how much energy it takes to move forwards, and how much energy is trying to stop your murderous mobile smog factory. Let's dive deeper. Or we can drive deeper. The oomph that any vehicle can generate is largely based on the engine it uses and its mass. More efficient engines can better utilize fuel, and heavier things are just plain harder to push forward, as anyone who's ever existed would know. I'm pretty sure a metaphor isn't needed here. Therefore, your base fuel efficiency is roughly proportional to the engine efficiency over your mass. But we don't really care about engine efficiency at the moment, as we're talking about using the same vehicle. So the engine efficiency will remain as constant as VPN sponsorships on YouTube. So into the bin with it! Looking at resistance to forwards movement, we mainly have air resistance, which doesn't matter as it's dependent on aerodynamics and speed. Or if you have an Audi, pedestrians. While you could make a very feeble argument for an absolutely minuscule aerodynamic advantage from having a slightly heavier vehicle with compressed suspension, I am just not having it. Another type of resistance is rolling resistance, or the loss of power due to your tires gripping and sticking like Genghis Khan to anything that isn't Mongolia. Yet. It is, however, roughly linearly related to mass, but not any other traits that can change as you fuel up. Lucky how that turned out, isn't it? So, armed with this knowledge, we can make an approximate equation that states our adjusted fuel efficiency is equal to our fuel efficiency multiplied by the mass of the car divided by the mass of the car plus the fuel. I've divided the mass of the fuel here by 2, as I'm assuming you're going to drive the car to empty before refueling. Therefore, it's average. So I'm going to plug the values in for a 2009 red Toyota Yaris, because it's a very popular car. I mean, but look at this thing. Look at this story. I mean, seriously, look at that. There's a cup holder here. There's another storage thing here. You got a little map compartment down there. You got a glove box here. Another glove box down here. CD player. Central dash thingamajig before Tesla did it. And it's actually really, really great. Oh, and another cup holder over there. Best car.
And according to the graph, the most efficient amount of fuel is zero. Of course it's zero. That's the lowest possible mass for the car to push forwards. So there we have it. The most efficient fuel to fill up your car with is as little gasoline as possible. The perfect percentage petrol is zero. So that's the end of the video. I'll talk about it. If you fill up your car less, you'll need to drive to the gas station more. This is effectively a waste of fuel and should be accounted for. So I'm adding another term to our equation. Percentage fuel not wasted on driving to the gas station, or PFNWADTGS for short. Basically, PFNWADTGS is equal to the distance of fuel purchased minus the distance of fuel used to drive to the gas station divided by the distance of fuel purchased. I'm also going to change the distance of fuel purchased with the volume of fuel multiplied by the base fuel efficiency so that we have a unit we're familiar with. Sorry for all the math, but I guess you fell for the bait of a quirky question and clicked on a math video by mistake. So that's on you. You're in too deep now. There is no return. Now, we can multiply our adjusted fuel efficiency by PFNWADTGS and convert the mass of fuel into volume of fuel multiplied by density. Now we have a general equation for the fuel efficiency of a car based on how much fuel is purchased at every fill-up that accounts for the extra trips to the gas station. Hooray! Now, whew. Now, this is a general equation and I will leave a link to it below, but let's find out exactly how much gas I should fill up my girlfriend's 2009 red Toyota Yaris 5-door hatchback with for maximum fuel efficiency. Fuel efficiency is again 13 kilometers per liter, mass of 1,043 kilograms, and I probably have a detour around a kilometer and a half combined to get to the gas station. That generates this mathematical function, which as you can see is relatively flat starting at around 5 liters, although it does have a peak at around 18 liters. But this is no fun. Graphs are great and all, but it would be much more convenient to just have a direct equation for the maximum adjusted fuel efficiency. And for that, I'm going to do a little bit of calculus. You can see here that MAFE is at the top of the curve, where the slope is effectively zero. We can use differential calculus here to find the slope of the curve. Now, yes, I'm aware that I've made my equation very ugly, but don't worry. All you really need to know is that it simplifies down to this. Much more manageable. So to achieve MAFE, our differentiated efficiency must be zero, as at the peak of anything, there is never a slope. And actually, now that I'm looking at this, it appears we don't actually need the denominator at all. So we'll just ignore it and make the numerator zero. That is way more simple, and we can just solve for volume now using the quintessential quadratic equation. And simplify. So our general formula for the most efficient amount of fuel to put in your car is as follows. Volume equals station detour distance divided by the base fuel efficiency multiplied by open parentheses 1 plus the square root of 1 plus 2 times the base fuel efficiency multiplied by curb weight divided by station detour distance divided by fuel efficiency. And for my little Toyota, that comes out to around 18.03 liters.
That's dollars.
Oh shit, that's not liters. So close! 0.05.
Thanks for hanging on with me through the math there. Did you skip ahead? Did you skip the most magnificent morsel of the movie? Shame on you! Go back. Yes, go back. Witness the mathematics. It'll be worth it. I promise. Go on. So I did the math here for a bunch of the more popular cars out there. I think these are the most popular selling cars in the US. I'm not really sure. But if you drive a car, and you drive one of these cars, then here's a handy-dandy fancy-spancy chart for you. Gas station detour distance is on the top, and the numbers in the middle are your maximum efficiency volume in liters. As we can see here, your maximum efficiency volume increases as your station detour distance increases. And for cars with abysmal fuel efficiencies, such as the Ford F-150, the lowest listed fuel efficiency is already very high, at 45 fucking liters. That's a whole keg. And a half. Talk about a lame party. I wouldn't want to be the guy who shows up with a keg of gasoline.
Hey, I brought some drinks for the party. Ooh, nice. Can I have some? Aww. I imagine this is how parties would go if I ever left my desk.
Another interesting little tidbit is my little Toyota has a far lower maximum efficiency volume than anything on this chart, and that's simply because it's much lighter, and therefore the fuel is a greater percentage of its mass. I did also include the Tesla Model 3 here, as it was on the list I pulled from. And obviously, as batteries do not decrease in mass as you expend their power, this list just doesn't really apply to them. Although batteries do have a limited lifespan, and they should probably just be charged in a way to maximize that. Now, obviously this is all rather negligible, and really, you could probably save more fuel by just skipping breakfast, or removing your spare tire, or driving slower, or you could just take the train.